Welcome everyone to our ongoing attempts to be very sober-minded here, okay, and go through this disillusioning process. Essentially, what we need to realize is that our entire lives, none of us have needed to suffer at all. That is a fact. All the suffering was completely unnecessary in our lives. That is the heavy realization. And I'm going through that, and you can go through that too. We can go through it together. Because the fact is that this, the grace of God to give us the steady state of vision has been with us our entire life, right with us. It's like we have a bird in the hand, but we're out searching for two in the bush. It's like that. And so we've overlooked the grace that is with us to solve the continuity problem. And our whole lives we've been frantically searching for something better, grander. You know, the ego has tricked us our whole lives. That's a fact. So it's better to realize this now than on your deathbed, okay? You know, because if you wait till then, you say, well, what's the use? You know, it's doesn't help me at all. People generally do not realize this on their deathbed. So it's time to realize it now. We have wasted all our suffering, and in many cases, that's an incredible amount of suffering, totally unnecessary. We could have lived our entire lives free of all suffering, entirely free, in this equal vision state of a seamless, beautiful overlay with bliss. We could live our entire life in this steady bliss, everless equanimity. We could have done that. Any one of us, all of us, could have done that, and yet we chose to suffer hideously, unnecessarily. So this is just an enormous realization. It's the key realization when you get to this point. You see, and I've been knocking on the door, knocking. Now it's getting easier. It's getting easier to accept this. And I tell you, this just sitting with this realization, someone who's willing to say this, is invaluable. It's absolutely invaluable. It's invaluable for me to have the opportunity to make this video for and share it with the world. That's also invaluable for me, but the function of admitting this and bringing it to light and accepting it is just like, holy cow. That's all we need to do, really. If you want to boil down everything right now to its essence, all we need to do is to accept the fact that we never had to suffer at all in the first place. Not this life, not any life. We could have accepted God's grace of healed perception. We could have always had that. It was always available. It's always been available. Still is available for us. Constantly available. And yet, the ego has tricked us into... The ego says, oh, that's great. Congratulations. Okay, now you're ready for the next step. It's an even bigger one. You're going to get really great now. And we are shamed away from accepting this bliss in our lives. We're shamed away from it. The ego works on us, psychologically tricking us. So these are the facts, and all we need to do is focus in on this one key area. That's it. But it's a tough one, isn't it? But you might as well get into the tough stuff. It's like eating a hot pepper. You know, you eat a little bit at a time. And it's hot, but eventually you finish it. You put a little lime on it, and it cuts the heat. So you can cut the heat. You drink and eat yogurt, ice cream or yogurt, and it, you know, it cuts the heat a little bit, and eventually you can do it. Super hot. This is like a super hot issue. The hottest issue, really. There's no other hot issue like this. This is it. I've wasted my entire life. The ego has tricked me my entire life. I never even had to suffer at all. My entire life, not one bit of suffering did I ever need to go through. I could have lived my entire life in this flawless bliss and helped the world out so much. I could have done all of that, and I didn't do it. I've been tricked my whole life. This is the admission. This is the heart of repentance, actually. So when we say repent, people are not willing to do that. They say, no. But this is the heart of repentance, is this admittance. And it's great. It's great to be able to say that. This is what really melts the ice cube, you know. This is what does it. So if we want to save time, save delay, this is where we stay, and with this insight right here. We've wasted our lives. We've been tricked. The ego's tricked us again. Got fooled again. All right, fine. But this time, it didn't fool us our entire lives, you see? That's how it's different. This time we caught the ego. We've got the ego now red-handed. We have this beautiful bird of grace in our hands, and the ego says, wow! You know what? That reminds me a lot of this other bird, which is even more magnificent. I mean, it's just incredible. But this kind of reminds me of it, and I'll help you go find this other bird that's even way, way, way better. And it looks like you're ready for it. Now you got this one. You know, let's go. Let's go get it. And off you go. It'll use all these tactics to keep you from accepting the actual, real solution to the continuity problem, which is within us right now. And that's what it's done. I mean, there's no other admission to make, but we've been tricked by the ego. Period. Everybody has been tricked by the ego. It's just most people don't realize it or cannot accept it. They're just too flustered by it. But definitely been tricked by the ego. Paradoxically, when you accept this and settle for what you already have, I would say theoretically your life is going to become much, 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 much better. Because most of us have tied ourselves in knots chasing after this non-existent other higher remedy the ego tells us is available for us and we're supposed to get because that's what we really deserve. The ego tells us, yeah, you got this beautiful bird of grace with you, but you deserve much better than that. Really, really, and don't sell yourself short. You know, it gives you this pep talk. Don't sell yourself short. You need to get out. You can really get higher than that. You can do better than that. And don't waste your potential. You know, all this kind of stuff. You need to be really self-actualized. Self-actualized. Reach your potential, your full potential. You're somebody special. You're really special. You need to acknowledge your specialness. You know, the ego will tell you all these lies. Meanwhile, this perfect healed perception, perception of emptiness, no thingness, of seamlessness, undisturbedness, peace beyond understanding. You already have it. All you have to do is pay attention to it. You know, pay attention. But the ego's got us looking over there. We're not paying attention. We're looking over there. And trying to actualize ourselves, trying to reach our full potential, trying to get what we really deserve. It's like somebody gave you $1 billion. So you have $1 billion in your bank account. Someone comes along and says, that's a nice start. But let me tell you something. You could be way richer than that. Someone like you, I mean, you're one of the most intelligent, talented, incredible people I've ever known. I mean, you have the potential to reach unbounded heights. Just, you know, you need to invest this money, do this. So your whole life you're frantically chasing after this rainbow, trying to realize your potential and get what you really deserve. And you're completely stressed out. Your health is wiped out. Your lifestyle is just frantic. And you just hate your life. Your mind, you can't sleep. You're tired. You're exhausted. You're depressed. Everything. All the while, you've got $1 million in your bank account. $1 billion in your bank account. sitting there. And you never even touch it. And then you die. It's like that. So just because you stop chasing after 100 billion, you know, you still got the billion. Why not enjoy it? Why not be a, you know, a spiritual billionaire right now? We all are spiritual billionaires right now. And the spiritual billion is all we need. All we need is this reminder of reality. We don't need to be chasing after some illusory pot of gold at the end of the rainbow. It's a trick. It's a trick of the ego that gets us thinking that we have to find something more than remembrance of reality. What could we need that's more than remembrance of reality? What? Remembrance of something prior to reality? Maybe? There isn't anything prior to reality. Something after never-endingness? There's no end to never-endingness. So we're chasing after a memory of something that doesn't exist. So no wonder why we don't find it. We keep thinking, I'm getting close. I must be around here somewhere. We never find it. We already have within us the way to remember reality, the way to be reminded is already within us, just waiting there for us, quietly waiting for this, patiently waiting until we finally pay attention to it and say, okay. It's like you live in a beautiful place, everything's perfect, and someone tells you, you know, wow, you're really missing out on this, something that's way better, incredible. And so you go out on a journey searching for this place, and through jungles and deserts and mountains and storms and starvation and sickness, and you just, your whole life you're trekking. And you think it's always just over this next mountain range. Are we going to find this some place that's just like even better than what I had? And you never find it. You die on the road. They bury you by the side of the road, dusty road. And nobody says anything. Didn't quite find it. Well, let's not dissuade others. So let's quick burial. Gone. Thank you very much. And rest you. Go on. No time to waste. Come on, you put so much effort into it already. You can't stop now. Come on. That's it. That's the world, isn't it? Ruthless. It's ruthless. Without mercy, without pity. I'll be thinking, we got to find this. We left something that was so perfect, and now here we are, and we're lost. Terrible. So, trick of the ego. The big trick. Get you to overlook what you already have. And you've always had it. You've always had it. So this teaching really is the heart of it all. It really is. This abiding in this repentance is the heart of it, because you have to go through this repentance. Is feeling like, oh my gosh, I didn't have to suffer. All the suffering was completely in vain, utterly unnecessary. And all the suffering I will undergo in the future is entirely unnecessary. Put it that way, it wakes you up, doesn't it? Because what's past is past. You say, oh, I already made it through there. But if you say, yeah, all the suffering I'm going to go in the future is also totally necessary, that's when you wake up. Uh-oh. Wow, hey, wait a minute. I don't want to keep suffering. So this ego is very tricky. Why? It's our desire to be prime creator, desire to be prior to reality, prior to spaciousness, pure spaciousness, prior to God, to be greater than God, to be the prime creator, to be the creator of all that is. That's our desire. So of course, the remembrance of reality is with us, but we say, oh no, we want something better. We want to remember what it was like prior to reality. And so that's what we're seeking for. So we're seeking for something that doesn't exist. We're seeking of a memory of what it was like prior to reality. There is no such memory. There's no such recollection. There's no way to be reminded of what can never exist. There's no way. But we can engage in a meaningless search. Absolutely. Full of suffering and you know, in turn. Because the way we try to remember what was prior to reality is we envision reality dying. And say, okay, this is reminding. Okay, this is reminding me. How did I get to be prior to reality? Oh, reality died, and then I was able to get away from it somehow, separate from it, and be prior to it. Okay, so we see all this impermanence, all this death, all this crumbling, all this failure stuff in the world. It's like, oh yeah, okay, that reminds me of how I got to be prior to reality. Reality stopped being what it was, you see. So we're either seeing this fakery, made up fakery of suffering and impermanence and death, thinking that that's reminding us of how we got to be prior to reality, or we are remembering reality as it is, which is bliss. So we're either in suffering or in bliss. There's no other option, actually. Cat, you had your time here. Yeah, can't come back. Sometimes you just have to say, that's it, that's enough. Cat was here all day, and now he wants to come back? No, it's my time now. You just say that to the ego. Hey, ego, it's my time now. I've decided to accept remembrance of reality instead of trying to gain a recollection of what has never happened. That's why none of this stuff in the world sinks in, right? We spend a whole lifetime suffering in this impermanence, and we say, I just don't quite remember. I just don't quite remember what it's not quite reminding me of enough. I need one more life. Go on, cat. Out. I need another life. I didn't quite remember it this time, right? It's hazy, it's confused, I can't quite put a piece of it together, you know. That's because there is no such memory, there is no such, how can you be reminded of what doesn't exist? How can you have a memory of what never happened? You can't. So it doesn't remind us of anything. But we hold out hope, like one day all the suffering is going to finally remind me of something. It doesn't. It never will. How can suffering remind us of reality? It doesn't. And there is no prior to reality, so it can't remind us of that either. So this is the fast way. Repentance is the fast way, is the only way, really. Otherwise, you're going to still be struggling along. So we're simply abiding in the mood of repentance here. That's it. And if you can catch the drift of this, then you're very fortunate. If you can just sort of say, I sort of get this. I sort of get the drift of this. I, you know. Abiding in the mood of repentance is it. And just getting over the you know, forgiving myself. You know, wow, I was tricked again. But and just saying, okay, you know, this is the direct path. Abiding in this mood of repentance is the direct way. It leads directly to accepting the outpouring of grace that produces this steady state of perception, this beautiful vision of no thingness, emptiness, whatever you want to call it, is an incredible healed perception, which reminds us of reality. It's the direct way to do it. So it's the quick way. And we don't really have time to be going out on excursions at this point, looking for something better. You know, we don't. So we need to abide in this mood of repentance, actually. Now, a very pragmatic guru is someone who's able to get you to do that really profoundly. So that's what I've been praying for. Yeah, I mean, somehow we have to get right on the front page here, and simply continually abide in this mood of repentance here. And it hits hard. It hits hard. But the flip side of it is, it says, yeah, but I'm not fooled anymore. Yeah, I was fooled my whole life, but not anymore. And so how can that be a bad thing, really? I mean, at some point, the scales got to tip, don't they? And just say, hey, this is great. Instead of, oh, what an idiot I was, you know. Well, you and everybody else. But you don't have to be idiot forever. That's the good news. So there is an end to suffering, absolutely. Those people are prone who have suicidal tendencies. They need the help of this sort of thing, of abiding in the mood of repentance at some point. And they'll say, hey, wait a minute. This is better. This is way better. Those with severe problems, they're desperately trying to find something else. And they've reached the end of the line. They say, I just can't keep on seeking. And they think this, I'm a loser. They think I'm a complete loser. And that I'm just terrible. No, you're simply trying to find what doesn't exist, trying to be reminded of something that has never been and never will be. And the remedy for that is to this mood of repentance and saying, hey, there's good news, great news, actually. We already have the answer to the continuity problem. Not only do we never need to suffer anymore, we never had needed to suffer at all in the first place, we just got tricked out of our own desire to deceive ourselves, but it's all forgivable, it's all forgiven, and we just need to kind of sit in this mood of forgiveness, repentance and forgiveness, and let it all melt away, this regrets melt away, you know. And that's the issue. How do we let them melt away? Can, you know, how fast will they melt? I don't know, but just have to keep at it. It's important. Like, my future looks so terrible. You know, I have to get this, you know, accept this now. Otherwise, forget it. There are no prospects. Don't have prospects. So this is like essential. And a lot of us feel like, wow, I just don't think I can, you know, have a really robust future. It doesn't look that way. Well, repentance and accepting what we already have, which is the resolution of the continuity issue, which is already within us, that provides bliss, unending bliss, unalloyed, untainted, unstained, pure bliss, seamlessly. And then, you know, you don't need a future at that point. Because you always feel that way. You just abide in each moment, and your life will change for the better, for sure. Because you're not destroying yourself by a desperate search. So hopefully the Long Chen Pa Guru can help us out with this. Anybody who can really help us out is fine. I don't care who. I'm just saying that this is it. This is what we have to abide in, this mood of repentance. Just accept. You know, I was tricked. I was tricked by the ego to go search in the bush what I already had in my hand the whole time. I was tricked to go on a journey I never needed to go on. I was tricked, and therefore I suffered terribly, but I didn't need to. And I don't need to anymore now or in the future at all, ever again. And so whatever can help us get in this mood of forgiving ourselves for tricking ourselves, being tricked like this, then that saves us a lot of suffering, a lot of time. We ask, how can we help save us from suffering? This is the way. This is the way, by saying we never had to suffer. Nobody needed to suffer ever. The answer has always been with us. Concurrent. This answer was given concurrently with our choosing to want to be Prime Creator, be prior to reality, was this resolution of this continuity issue. We knew that God knew would arise, a continuity issue. So it's always been with us. So we never actually had to have any births or deaths, ever had to suffer at all, not even for a moment, never. This applies to everyone, and everything. So all these techniques and all this tantra, we're doing these practices and techniques, trying to, you know, prayers and trying to get something better. It's unnecessary. Never is. It was never necessary. Salvation is a gift. Grace is a gift, freely given. There's no. You don't earn it. Nobody has to earn it at all. There's no price on it. No payment. No. You don't have to earn it. It's given, freely given. By the Prime Creator, freely given, just reminding us, hey that there isn't anything prior to creation. So nothing prior to pure spaciousness. There's nothing abiding outside of pure spaciousness. So just be reminded of that fact. You don't need anything. Don't search for something grander than the reminder of this fact, because what you're really searching for then is to be reminded of priorness or outside spaciousness. That's what you really are searching for, is a reminder of that which doesn't exist. Bug time here. That's okay. Little bugs flying around here, just enjoying the light. The sun is getting so low already, isn't it? On the horizon here. Good grief. It's setting way, way, way to the south already. Wow. A mole is going through our garden. But the good thing about a mole, it doesn't kill any of the plants. It's just going everywhere. It's just eating worms, you know, basically. But if somehow it doesn't bother the plants, it's uh-oh, the cat is back. It doesn't bother the plants. So I say, okay, I'm not bothered, mole. I don't know what the cat, what's your problem? You know, you're not supposed to be here now. Come on. All right. See, he's hungry. He's hungry, that's why. Hey, cat, we're abiding in the mood of repentance here. Okay? You understand that? See? So the ego will come and say, hey, okay, it's time to go get something better. Say, no, we don't need anything. There is nothing better, because what you're really saying is time to go seek for a reminder of priorness to reality. There is no such state. How can we be reminded of what can never exist? That the reminder would be suffering and chaos. You know, trying to get reminded of it, the state of total chaos would be how we would try to remind ourselves of that, right? Being reminded of what has never been would be complete chaos. We have no recollection at all. A recollection of complete no recollection. That's terrible. Absolutely terrible. So, don't let the ego trick you, like it keep tricking you. Keep coming back to this abidance in repentance, the mood of repentance. Keep abiding in the mood of repentance. Demographics, 174 countries, but view time, all that stuff here, doesn't matter, does it? Now, these insights are so heavy, you kind of need to take time with it. You know, it's not just a fast food thing. A few minute thing and say, okay, I got it. I never need to suffer. I've been tricked my whole life. Okay, now I need to keep going, chasing after that recollection. No. Recollection is always already within us. We simply need to forgive ourselves for not paying attention to it, and actually do pay attention to it, and let that be. Okay, Kat, you're really... See, the cat is thinking about the next move. What kind of next move? You know, how's it going to disturb me, you know? I should probably be proactive and just say, go. Go ahead. Don't let him get any ideas. So the mood of the world is non-repentant. Okay, so it's not like you're going to be, when you're around people, you're around a repentant people at all. You're not. Very rare to ever be around anyone who's actually in a mood of repentance. Extremely rare. I don't know if I've ever been in such a situation. Just to admit, hey, my whole life has been nothing but a complete farce, complete waste of time. I've been completely tricked by the ego. I needn't have suffered in the slightest bit ever. And, you know, just to really see it like that. So people are not repentant in this world. So it's difficult to practice it as you go about your day. If you're in an environment of, you know, it's like being in water and trying not to get wet. It's like that. But that's why we're taking time here. Just a little time set aside from the ego to actually look at this. And no, you don't have to recount any particular suffering. All suffering was entirely unnecessary. Not just some, all of it. Whether your suffering's been a lot or a little, it was still equally unnecessary, totally unnecessary. So we don't have to spend time, you know, impressing others like, oh, I didn't suffer very much, or I've suffered so terrible, oh, unbelievably terrible. You know, it's still unnecessary. It's still just a trick of the ego. Everything, all the dynamics are exactly the same in every case. we tried to go after remembrance of priorness to reality. However, the ego marketed to us. That's actually what we're trying to desire. And we overlooked the grace of God that we already have. It's the same in every case. And will be the same in every case forever until everyone finally repents. So it's very simple. A teacher is not somebody who has all this great complexity going on. You know, no, there's this simple, true remedy for everybody. It applies to everyone equally. So there's no complexity. You may think, oh, how can I possibly help anybody? You know, I got to figure so many things out and blah, 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 blah. No. It doesn't matter what sign of the astrological sign they are or what kind of enneagram they are, what kind of this or that, or their star charts, none of that makes any difference whatsoever. What race, language, culture, gender, nothing, age, makes no difference. It's all the same for everybody. Everybody's getting tricked by the ego. Everybody needs to repent. Everybody has the grace of healed perception already within them. And so, that's all there is to it. Here comes the cat. Cat! You just don't give up. Okay. Sit down. Stop being restive. Okay. Go ahead and sit down. Come on. All right. Okay, see there. Okay. Temporarily. So the ego will try to get your attention like that and bother you, distract you, and you just have to say, hey, sit down. You know, the cat wants to go eat. You know, in other words, the ego wants to eat. The ego says, I'm hungry. I need for you to go searching. You say, no. You'll have to wait. I'm not searching anymore. Now, we may think that accepting that we didn't need to suffer at all is the worst suffering of all. That was all unnecessary. Well, that's the question that we have in the back of our minds. And I don't have the answer to that in myself entirely at this point. That's our fear. It's like, oh boy, I might be so despondent that I've gone through this, you know, just a chamber of horrors, and I never needed to do it at all. I had the key the whole time. I've been searching high and low for the key, and I have it. I've had it with me the entire time. It's really, it's like someone who's searching everywhere for their glasses. You know, people say, whoa. And finally, you know, somebody says, what are you searching for? And they say, my glasses, I can't find them. And they say, you're wearing them. What? And you think, oh my God, I've been so stupid. Can you believe that? I've been wearing them the entire time, and here I was searching for them. But if you see, this is because your desire to be reminded of not reality, but something prior to reality, that's what caused you to be temporarily completely stupid like that. You just had a desire to overlook remembrance of reality. It's just your desire that did it. So it's not really stupidity. It's not really stupidity. It's this desire. I think Buddha said the desire is the root of all suffering. Well, exactly. And you can say it's the root of all continued suffering too. Our desire to be reminded of what has never been or can never be causes the suffering. And we're not aware that the answer of all our problems is already with us. We're already wearing the glasses. We already have the key. So we keep on suffering. And the desire is causing that. So desire is definitely the root of all suffering. So this is such a profound realization that one needs to continue on in this mood of examination, mood of repentance, and keep at it. Keep at it. It's not just a snap of the fingers thing, because we it's such a it's such an incredible thing. It's hard to wrap our mind around it. You know, just all the travails of our life has been full of, we never had to go through any of that. It was all completely unnecessary. And all of the rationalizations for why it was necessary are all egoic rationalizations, all of them. And there's a ton of them out there. We don't have any lessons to learn in existence, none. We only need to be reminded of reality. It's only when we're searching for it to be reminded of non-existent priorness to reality that we think there's all these lessons, and we rationalize our aimless, meaningless wandering around us. We're going through a program. We're learning. We're learning valuable lessons. This is a teaching moment. We're gaining. Our soul is growing. We're expanding our soul awareness. We're doing, you know, all these rationalizations come up then, telling you that this is all justified and good, all for the good, and that keeps you seeking. So when the teacher says, "Hey, drop all seeking right now," they say, "What are you talking about? I'm doing my spiritual practices. This is my life. I'm learning a lot. I'm suffering terrible, but I'm also, you know, trying to learn how to heal this and heal that and overcome this and that, and I'm hoping to be a better person in my next life." And I'm now, those are all delusionary rationalizations. What we're really doing is desiring to remember priorness to reality, which has never been and never will be. So there is no way to recollect it. There is no it to recollect. And that's the one thing we refuse to look at. So we keep inventing these, you know, excuses to keep jumping through all these hoops and suffering. Nobody knows when somebody is finally going to accept it, forgive themselves and accept us. And when they do, for sure, they're going to be in bliss, for sure. But I don't know when I'm going to do it. And there's still this sort of sense of, like, kind of, you know, heaviness about it. Like, wow. What a shocker. The feeling, you know, when you go through suffering, you have this feeling, all along you have this feeling like, I don't think this is necessary. We have that, but I just be on the safe side, I'm going to go along with it. There's that feeling, right? The back of your mind, you're saying, I don't really have to go along with this, but I want to be on the safe side, so, you know, okay. And there's this conflict, right? And so, you're conflicted. And now you're recognizing, hey, I really didn't need to. That's a fact. My momentum kept dragging me along, and all this rationalization kept pulling at me. All this marketing kept me saying, going against my, you know, inner wisdom. But that's over now, that can be over now. Don't need to do that anymore. Evening time here, dusk. Another picture postcard day. Supposedly it's going to rain Tuesday. I don't know, but this so far, November has been very nice. But we need the rain in California. We need the rain. It's been a drought. We haven't had any rain for 11 months, really. Maybe one time, but other than that, nothing. Dry as a bone here. So when you're in the mood of repentance, you don't need to be in a hurry. Don't need to be in a hurry. So far I haven't found any, it doesn't become overwhelming. But, you know, solemn, somber, serious. Don't worry if the full weight of it doesn't sink in. No, it doesn't happen like that usually. There's a little bit of the time. You kind of say, well, just wow, let me get used to this fact. You know, let me absorb this. It takes time to absorb it because it is so monumental. It is so monumental. It's like you found the key. You've been looking for your whole life. You had it the whole time, and you're looking at it. It's like you don't know what to say or do. You're dumbfounded by it. There's this feeling like you're just dumbfounded, like, wow. It's very heavy. Just imagine if you've been out starving, out in the wilds, exposure to the elements, suffering, shivering, barely, been sick so many times, and just depressed, and so many troubles in your mind and body, and because you can't get inside that door. And then one day you look and you realize you had the key all along. All along you had this key. Yeah. So it's dumbfounding. You just have to get used to it. I'm struggling with it, but you know it's a good struggle. That's what the spiritual path is all about: is struggling with this mood of repentance. That's the direct approach. That's the one that can work right now for you. That can bring your long, desperate sojourn to an end, actually. It can bring your suffering to an end. That's what does it. At some point, you have to get to that repentance and realize, I never needed to suffer, ever. None. Never. Never needed to suffer. Always had the key with me the whole time. You have to get to that consideration. You have to. That's why maybe sometimes you, if there's a real teacher, some people are sitting there, they're kind of like, they're not, don't seem too happy, you know, it's like, it's dawning upon them. Like, oh my gosh, I've been a complete idiot. I never need to suffer at all. Oh my gosh, what, oh, you know, it's just like this, it's such a huge realization. And they may sit there, you know, for a long time, or just like, and finally one day they say, okay, I'm okay with it now. That's it. They're in bliss then. So yeah, I mean, there's a shock to it. That's why it's helpful to do it with other people, probably, or going through it. Lighten the load, have a little humor, and it's like, oh my gosh. It's hard to know what to even say about it. Like, I didn't have to go through all this stuff. Wow. Holy cow. So you make it a soft landing, you know, the idea is you make it a soft landing. And some people may get it quit more quickly, for sure. And they may not be the people you expect. And somebody may just like, okay, I get it, and that's it. They're finished. They're finished. The grace, they've accepted the grace of God, and then they're perceiving this beautiful healed perception and experiencing bliss, and that's it. They're done. And others may take a little bit longer, but that doesn't matter. I mean, there's some of us who have suffered terribly a long time, and it's like really shocking to recognize this. Others may have kind of all along think, you know what, I don't really need to do this, and they kind of stayed away from it, the suffering. And so then it's easier maybe for them to just say, okay, drop it. I don't know. Everyone's different, but so don't worry about what others are thinking or doing or how fast or what or not. Forget it. Just stay with your own process. I never needed to suffer. Okay, that's good for now. We're putting this out very fast now because the opportunities for suffering in this world are going to be greatly expanded. The bandwidth, the suffering bandwidth, is going to be going fiber optic, you know, on us pretty soon. And if, you know, if you're still tricked by the ego, oh boy, does the ego have some suffering for you. It's really going to try to help you remember what the experience of being prior to reality. It's really going to go all in on that. And, you know, the back of your mind is saying, no, I don't need that. So you don't want it, but you're still saying, you know, you're still not quite sure. Well, this is what this is for here, to clarify it for you, Christ's clarity, clarify it for you, reassure you, remain in the mood of repentance. Okay? Very great. That's it. Stay with it.